both on the battlefield without the necessary resources, and when they come back as veterans without any benefits, and now they have no mental health benefits, they have no physical benefits, and we're having the cheapest amount of labor given to these veterans who have served our country honorably. So what I'm saying to you very clearly is this is a civilian psyops game that continues from presidency to presidency. We in the United States can no longer have two-party systems where we have a Republican and Democrat, where it really is not functioning very well, and it's costing the American public a fortune in both blood and guts and money. We've spent over $333 billion, approximately $50 million for every so-called terrorist that was taken out of Afghanistan, which were about 2,000 terrorists. Now, if you can find me 2,000 more terrorists in Pakistan, I will give you a couple of more million, because they don't exist. Karzai, the Pakistanis, have worked together to make sure that we are not able to acquire any assets there. Now, what does this result to? We're not going to go to World War III, but what's happening is another form of economic warfare has entered, and that is China, who has benefited from all of what we have done, the dysfunctional behavior and the misassessment and the lack of strategy and the lack of leadership and the disasters that we have created with the drones and our CIA so-called operations where we've killed civilians. We've alienated the Pakistanis, who in turn have invited the Chinese to come down and work with them, both militarily and economically. And what has Karzai said publicly? I don't want the Americans here because he already has raped and ripped us of about $3 billion a day, a week. And at the same time, he has asked the Chinese to come in and invest in Afghanistan. Now, that's the reality.
And by the way, Karzai's brother on record is the biggest opium dealer in Afghanistan. Now, looking
that's
at this,
correct.
Looking at this, I talked to you earlier during the break, and you said you heard General Hamid Ghul, former head of Pakistani intelligence, on, and that you had to agree with what he said. You just alluded to that.
Right.
But specifically, let's go into your history, because you know the entire, or much of the entire leadership of Pakistan and Afghanistan from the Afghan war with the Russians.
Yes. Thank you, Alex. That's very kind of you. I really know them way before the Afghan war. I was involved in the major hostage situation in Washington called the Hanafi Muslim. I was brought in by Earl Silbert when 350 hostages were taken in Washington, and I was able, through 36 hours of negotiating against the orders of Carter. I actually threw out Jimmy Carter outside. So you can see I don't always acquiesce to a civilian controller president. And basically there was a very important gentleman who worked with me named Yaqub Khan. Yaqub Khan was the foreign minister of Pakistan, was our ambassador to the United States, but was the father of the Pakistani army. As a result of that, I got to know the various generals throughout his ranks, who they were, and he talked to me about Elzia, Musharraf, Benazir Bhutto, her father, what would happen. So I intimately got to know both the military elements of this incredible army that was trained under General Yaqub Khan, and a friend of mine was also the head of the Islamic Brotherhood. Believe it or not, we went to MIT together. So I knew all of these elements, and I knew they were extremely sensitive to our relationship with America. And at the time, they were useful in the fight against the Soviet Union. But at the same time, I was clearly warned very early on that they would turn against us and basically have a blowback, which you've talked about in the past. So using Yaqub Khan, I knew exactly where the elements were, the concerns they had about the CIA continuously supporting the Interservice Intelligence Agency, the fact that the ISI was getting out of control, was no longer under military or civilian control in Pakistan, and was beginning to form their own so-called groups, or we call terrorist groups, as a forefront to making sure that Pakistan had a ancillary army, or basically an auxiliary army, or paramilitary unit that could fight against India. And one of the things your audience has to understand, Pakistan's greatest obsession right now is not with the Taliban or Haqqa. Those are the groups that they support even till today.
It's with India.
I'm sorry, it's with India. That is correct, Alex. India is their greatest obsession. And I would speak to the general and other Pakistani officials and explain to them, look, India is not an issue for you. India is twice the size you are. They have twice the number of nuclear warheads. You have 600,000 soldiers. At that time, they had 2.2 million. Kashmir is not an issue. Nevertheless, India, Pakistan to this day has felt very strongly that India is sending down operatives through the Chinese and other Soviets into Afghanistan and are using those operatives in order to get a possession into Afghanistan. And at the same time, Pakistan feels that India is infiltrating the Kashmir. So there's a whole other scenario which we have not been able to handle. When Richard Holbrooke was brought in as the envoy to the South Asia, he was told you can handle anything you want, but you will not touch Pakistan and India or Kashmir. That was cut out. So from a foreign policy point of view, we have never had the strong hand or the foresight of, let's say, whatever you think of Kissinger or Baker, who could very forcefully say, no, that's not going to happen. Or we had the strategic sense under various other presidents where we knew exactly where we wanted to go. Like Bush Sr. said, we're not going into Iraq. It wasn't a question. He was afraid of Saddam Hussein, or he wasn't, or it was unfinished work. Bush Sr. was brilliant in foreign policy. We had taken down the Soviet Union quietly. We had taken down East Germany quietly. We had taken down apartheid quietly. And we had taken down Debussy, a whole bunch of other countries. Not one word was said. When his son came in, he said, I don't listen to my father. We said, good God, what an incredibly incompetent, arrogant individual. Yet his father never said a word. So when you have a man like Bush Sr. who's able to control and direct both the intelligence community, the CIA, under whom Gates, Bob Gates, who is an excellent Secretary of Defense, and I'm sorry to see him go because I think that's a great loss to our country. He has really tried to control and direct our Defense Department in the right way and cut back programs that were not necessary, the F-22, the stealth, and really provide our special forces with the necessary equipment they needed, we're going to lose a very valuable man. In turn, I have very big questions about Panetta and his capabilities. I do not think he performed well at the CIA. I think he exacerbated a very serious situation with the Pakistanis, and I think General Petraeus will have a hard time because it's a military man coming into a civilian organization, which General Eisenhower once said about the CIA, you need a certain kind of genius to run that organization. So right now, what's happening is civilian control, which is both untutored, undisciplined, and without a history of any military or intelligence expertise, is now going forward. There's one more reason why Osama bin Laden came out of the dead, so to speak, the resurrection, or the PSYOP's resurrection of Osama bin Laden. And that is, for the first time, you've heard people like Clapper and the director of the National Intelligence Organizations and the Center for Counterterrorism and all the intelligence organizations, which amount to God knows how many now, have really worked together and effectively. So it's a justification to say that under Obama, we have really integrated our intelligence community so that we effectively can kill and we're able to kill a dead man, in my opinion. That Osama bin Laden was dead.
All right, let me ask you this question, sir. And again, if you've just joined us, Dr. Steve Pieczenik, stevepieczenik.com, the man that Tom Clancy's novels are based on, author and creator of 26 New York Times bestsellers. He was the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State and or Senior Policy Planner under Secretaries Henry Kissinger, Cyrus Vance, George Shultz, and James Baker. Dr. Pieczenik is also, as you heard, a medical doctor, continues to consult to the Department of Defense, is also a Council on Foreign Relations Fellow. You heard him, and he said it 9 years ago that they would do this. This is the PSYOP resurrection of Osama bin Laden. We'll find out exactly why. It isn't just about the re-election of... And that's what bin Laden is. He knows your anger. He knows your pain. He's that 6'4" boogeyman with a scary turban and the beard and the evil eye. And now we've had a victory. Man, America's coming together. Yeah, as the gas prices explode, as all of this tyranny unfolds, as, the Chinese are dumping more treasuries. They're talking about the U.S. losing its AAA rating. That's back in the news today. They say when they switch it, it may go to a C grade. That's CNBC. This is the country going into cardiac arrest, but we've got the royal wedding. We've got the bin Laden situation. And here is a very high-powered author, researcher, State Department, a former official, CFR fellow, breaking everything down, breaking ranks with the establishment to warn you. Now larger than just Obama, sir, and the re-election. I mean, that's all scripted. That's clear. Why else are they doing this? Because, I mean, we see the frame-up now of Pakistan going into high gear saying Bin Laden was at this house.
Well, one of the reasons they're doing it so that they basically can pull out of Pakistan, they can leave, try to leave Afghanistan and Iraq with the sense that there was a victory. There is no victory because there was no clear designation as to what the war would accomplish. We have no idea what the war accomplished other than 10 years of wasted bodies and brave men and women and $333 billion a year. Secondly, we now have a very serious economic issue with unemployment still up, exceedingly high, much higher than the designations. We have a banking crisis that hasn't been resolved. In 3 years, we've had banks after banks, Chase, Morgan Stanley, J.P. Morgan and Chase, Bank of America, all of them have committed crimes beyond the reason of the doubt. If you look at the Banking Commission report that's done by our own federal government, they indict them. And there's basically no attention to them, and nobody has even been prosecuted. And Obama went back to them yesterday and asked them for more money. They're going to raise $1 billion. We're also in a position where we are not doing very well in the international arena. We have literally lost our basic strategic superpower position. Although we have a large army, we're basically in the same position that the British military was in the 1900s, a very large army without a strategy, without a cause, and without a country. I often said to our military, we have an army without a country, and I say to our country that we have a country without a military, because right now it's costing us a fortune. We have no benefits derived from it. There are no enemies that we have other than the internal security of our country, which depends really on the debt, as you clearly said, and our financial growth, which is very low, 2 to 3%, and the fact that our bond ratings will be downgraded perhaps to a C or whatever the levels are. We have further problems. We have the notion that a system is not working, and that's what I keep coming back to since I said 10 years ago when we had Bush Jr., now we have Obama. We elect people who are basically panderers without any history of accomplishment, without any history of success, other than the fact that they pandered their way and agreed to acquiesce to anybody who's giving them money or power and represent other interests. Now, I'm not degrading anybody. I've treated politicians, and I've worked with them. But basically, the notion of a politician servicing the United States of American needs is absurd. We don't need these people anymore. And if we don't, if we think we do, then we're mistaken, because we're going to keep going on from administration to administration, from lie to lie, and from incompetence to incompetence. All of these people are reshuffled again. You have Panetta, who was in the Clinton administration, was not a great performer, now coming in from the CIA, where he was dysfunctional, to now heading up the Secretary of Defense.
Stay there. We've got the real live Patriot Games, Jack Ryan, Dr. Steve Pieczenik, going into overdrive. Stand by. Infowars.com. Ask yourselves, what are you doing in this time of great challenge? What are you doing to unlock minds?